Good day, everyone, and welcome back to TMac FPV, your home for your journey to better FPV fun, flights, and racing stuff. Today, we're going to continue on our little series on micro FPV drone parts, and we're going to be going over a video transmitter, specifically the Tbs Unify Pro 5G8 HV Race 2 MMCX version. In previous videos in our micro FPV drone parts series, we've covered things such as flight controllers and ESCs, microphones for FPV audio on your quadcopter, and side-by-side comparisons of various video transmitter antenna. If you haven't seen these, no worries. A link's going to pop up in the upper right-hand corner of this video for you to click on and go check those out as well. In today's video, we start a mini-series comparing a few possible great options for your micro FPV quadcopter video transmitter. See what we got stickers. Wires. Settings quick start. Nice. Little pad to stick it on. Okay, here's what it looks like. It's coming in at 26.9 millimeters. In length, 20 millimeters wide, 4 millimeters thick, and it's weighing in at 3 grams, plus or minus 1. Documentation shows it weighs 4.2 grams. This thing can take 2 to 6S input power. It has pit mode, 25 milliwatts, 100 milliwatts, and 400 milliwatts output power. And the reason they went with 25, 100, and 400 milliwatt output power levels instead of the normal 200 milliwatts above the 25 is that those output power levels mean that the range doubles for each one of the settings. So from 25 to 100 milliwatts, the range doubles, and the range doubles also from 100 to 400 milliwatts. It also has smart audio.
At this point, I have to take a moment of your time to explain the situation I came across. Both this video transmitter, the Tbs Unify Pro HV Race 2, and the Unify Pro 32 Nano come with version 2.1 smart audio. In my case, and in my configuration, using an external microphone and the flight controller in which I was using for this HV Race 2 VTX, I was not able to get the smart audio to work properly. Currently, I'm running Betaflight 3.5.4. However, other people have experienced this with the current version of Betaflight as well, which is 3.5.5. My understanding that there are potential workarounds for this problem until Smart Audio 2.1 is fully implemented in Betaflight. I've listed three potential workarounds here. The first one is to use the AKK fix firmware, which is known as the AKK and RDQ VTX patch, by going into the Betaflight configurator and showing unstable releases and then selecting it from the release menu. We did try this option to fix the smart audio, and in our case, it did not work. Another option exists to connect a 10 kilo ohm resistor from the smart audio pad to the ground pad. And if you need more information on that, and along with various diagrams based on your configuration and what you're trying to do with your flight controller and audio, you can go to this link here. A third option, which may in fact be the same as the first option, have the same effect, is to use Butterflight instead of Betaflight, and in the configurator tab of Butterflight, enable legacy underline SA underline support option, which has a slider button next to it, and to enable that, you just move the slider button to on. As I mentioned, this may have the same effect as option A above, which was implemented in Betaflight. However, we have not tested this option. So in our case, for this particular video transmitter, our smart audio was not working, and we actually changed the frequencies and the powers of our VTX by using the onboard push button and the LEDs. Now let's continue with the rest of the review.
And as always for me, the MMCX connector. One of the reasons we have this is it also has, in addition to smart audio, it also has an audio input pad, which means we can connect an external microphone to it to get audio while we're flying and also in our DVR videos.
Now's a good time for us to actually go over the features we're looking for in a video transmitter for our micro FPV quadcopter builds. Obviously, for our micro builds, we want to have the VTX to be small in size and weight, with an output power of greater than or equal to 200 milliwatts, max output power. We want a microphone on the VTX or an audio input pad to attach an external microphone, preferably an audio input pad, because the external microphones, as mentioned in our earlier video on microphones for FPV audio, are actually better at capturing good quality sound than the microphones that are either on a FPV camera or on the VTX. We do want an MMCX connector, if at all possible. That's my preference. They're more sturdy and more durable and reliable than the UFL connectors, in my opinion. We would also like smart audio or TRAMP protocol to be able to adjust our VTX powers and frequencies with our Taranis and through our OSD. Today is the first VTX that we'll be going over. As you can see, we've got five other columns that we could put video transmitters in and fill out the same sort of information. We'll be going over some of these, perhaps all of these, and fill out this entire chart. But today we'll be going over the TBS Unify Pro HV Race 2. It does have smart audio, as we mentioned. These are the dimensions. My scale came in at 3 grams, but my scale's accuracy is within 1 gram, and the documentation, as I mentioned earlier, shows that the weight of this particular VTX comes in at 4.2. We did say that the power input is 2 to 6S, and these are the power output levels. It does have the audio input pad, which we've demonstrated, and the MMCX, and it also has pit mode. The cost currently is $29.95. Of note, if you go to this website, maxmyrange.com, an individual there has created this site, which allows you to do the calculations for a maximum range based on various power levels. So I've gone ahead and captured those maximum ranges based on various power levels down here below, and you can, in this site, determine what type of antenna you're using. For these calculations, what I chose to do by going into this calculator was to use an omnidirectional transmitter and receiver antenna, those both being the Luminaire Axie with a gain of 1.6 dB. So for 25 milliwatts, the maximum range using a Luminaire Axie transmitter and receive antenna is approximately 0.53 kilometers, which equates to 0.33 miles. For 100 milliwatts, the maximum range is approximately 1.06 kilometers or 0.66 miles, which is exactly double what it is for 25 milliwatts, as you can see. And that's the rationale TBS used to come up with these output power levels. And for 400, you get 2.11 kilometers, approximately max range, with 1.31 miles, which is basically double the 100 milliwatts. These are for reference purposes only, and based on the antennas you use and the environment in which you fly, you may or may not get these types of ranges. Let's continue with our testing.
So we're going to check the power output levels of this VTX with our Immersion RC power meter. And then once we do that, we'll take it out for test flight, check out the range on its minimum output power level of 25 milliwatts and also its maximum output power level of 400 milliwatts so that you can get a good idea of the quality of the video this VTX puts out. All right, let's get to it. Okay, we're going to be testing out the three power levels of the TBS Unify Pro HV Race 2. And we're going to be doing so across the entire race band, channels 1 through 8. We're also going to be doing it on channel F4, which is at 5800 megahertz. The reason we're doing that is because this Immersion RC power meter is calibrated and steps at 50 megahertz increments. So, for example, when we check the power levels of race band 1, which is at 5658 megahertz, the meter will be set at 5650 megahertz. And the next step up from 5650 is going to be 5700 megahertz. So we will not be able to set the meter at the specific exact frequency of each one of the
race band channels. However, for F4 at 5800, we will be able to set the immersion RC RF power meter at exactly 5800. So that's the reason we're doing F4 in addition to the entire race band. Now, just to save time, we're not going to show the power level readings for all of the channels in race band. We're going to go through and show channel 1, and we're going to show channel F4. However, I'll include the results for the remaining channels that we do the testing on. Okay, right now we are on race band 1, 5658 megahertz, and our meter is set at 5650, and we've got a 25 milliwatt output setting on the VTX, and we're measuring 27. We'll bump this up to the next power setting, 100. Okay, and at the 100 power level setting, we are at about 135. At 400, we're coming in at about 421. Now we're going to do the same thing with race bands 2 through 8. I'm going to do that offline just to save some time, but I will go ahead and do the same thing with band F, channel 4 at 5800. Okay, we're on channel F4, 5800, 400 milliwatts, and we're getting 425. And at 100 milliwatts, we're getting about 108. And at 25 milliwatts, we are getting 27.
And these are the overall results for all 8 of the race band channels, along with channel F4. As you can see, there aren't any real outlying data points across the spectrum for all power levels. The VTX seems to be fairly consistent.
Okay, now it's time for us to take our quad and our VTX out to the field and do a couple test flights with it to check out the quality of the video reception that we're getting from the VTX itself. The field that we're going to be flying on is about 860 meters in length and about 150 meters wide. These measurements were obtained through a laser rangefinder, so they're fairly accurate. There are poles, power poles actually, along the field, which will provide us with good markers of distances. I've got them outlined here. Our starting point is just going to be right behind, distance-wise, from the first pole, and we're going to be flying in this direction towards the end of the field. Out here at this end of the field is a line of trees, which we're not going to go over or beyond. Our overall flight distance, if we went from pole A, our starting point, to the end of the field, is just over 800, actually 808 meters, which is about half a mile. But based on the video, you'll be able to keep these poles in the line of sight on the video. So you can actually count A, B, C, D, E, F, and determine from those the distances that we've actually flown. After the flights, if you found this video useful, give it a thumbs up. Remember to subscribe to the TMac FPV channel. And until next time, thanks for watching and happy flying. It's fly time.